My name is Josef and I am a research professor in the research unit Self-Directed Learning in the Faculty of Education at Northwest University. I've spent most of my career in pre-service teacher education, and I am one of three editors of a new AOSIS book entitled Becoming a Teacher, Research on the Work-Integrated Learning of Student Teachers. We are very excited about this book, and the three editors would like to tell you a little bit more about what this book entails. Research literature often speak of the so-called theory-practice divide, and that universities often do not adequately prepare student teachers for the challenging profession they have chosen. The book Becoming a Teacher, Research on the Work-Integrated Learning of Student Teachers, published by AOSIS, provides recent research findings on various initiatives related to the work-integrated learning of student teachers. The 12 chapters, although eclectic in nature, all speak to the central theme of ensuring good quality in teacher education, especially in the context of this book, pre-service teacher education. This book is number 4 in the Northwest University Self-Directed Learning book series. The research unit Self-Directed Learning focuses on research related to how self-directed learning could be enhanced, and this is of utmost importance in teacher education. As I have mentioned, we were three editors, and let's now meet the other two editors.
Thank you, Josef. Good day. I am Herman van Vuuren, the Deputy Dean Teaching and Learning in the Faculty of Education in the Northwest University. I have experience as a teacher, as a school principal, and as an academic. I am a proud member of the editorial team and author of the first chapter of the publication that Josef de Beer just mentioned and referred to. In life, there's a saying, you don't get a second opportunity to make a first impression. In the same vein, the first chapter of any book is crucial to introduce the reader to what follows. In this sense, chapter 1 of the book, Becoming a Teacher, Research on Work-Integrated Learning for Student Teachers, provides a sound foundation and leads the reader into the rest of the book. For all of those with an interest in work-integrated learning for student teachers, the substance of chapter 1 addresses some attention-grabbing and thought-provoking themes in this captivating publication. Chapter 1 with the title, The Journey of Becoming a Professional Teacher, Policy Directives and Current Practices, commences with an extensive description of related and prominent work-integrated learning concepts to ensure a sound underpinning for the analysis, the description, the arguments, and the reasoning in the book. One of the highlights of Chapter 1 is the focus on pertinent policy guidelines for work-integrated learning training programs. Relevant and important policy documents are presented, outlined, and relatedness is discussed to provide a clear and legitimate framework for providers of teacher training programs that involve work-integrated learning. Chapter 1 furthermore addresses some fundamental and quintessential themes, such as a rationale for work-integrated learning, related learning and assessment matters, mentoring, reflection, guiding principles to deal with diversity, and benefits to the role players. All are discussed extensively in Chapter 1. Together, the mentioned themes of Chapter 1 set a tone and serve as a substantial point of departure for the remaining 11 chapters of this much-needed publication about work-integrated learning of student teachers. I'm sure you will find this publication most interesting and of value to enhance knowledge and insight into this most important and interesting topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Herman. I am Neal, a research professor in the research unit Self-Directed Learning, Faculty of Education, Northwest University. I am an experienced life sciences school teacher and university lecturer. I am a co-editor of this book and co-authored 2 chapters. It is our experience over several years that first-year BEd students do not have an in-depth or nuanced understanding of the research teaching profession. Most of them think that they possess the knowledge and skills to start to teach even as first-year students. The Northwest University has initiated a 3-day excursion for all its first-year BEd students within the first 2 months of their academic year. On the first day of the excursion, we usually ask the students the following question. If a principal of a nearby school asks you to stand in for a teacher who is ill, whom of you would be willing to take that teaching job? Most of the students will then usually raise their hands, indicating that they will. On the contrary, if we would ask students to imagine that they were medical students studying to be medical doctors, who will be ready to perform an emergency operation on somebody the next day, then there are usually no one that feels that they will be up to it. The same would apply if they were engineering first-year students. None of them would feel prepared to go and design a bridge. In fact, the fact that education students feel that they are ready to teach can be linked to a phenomenon that Lorty in 1975 calls the apprenticeship of observation. This construct refers to pre-service teachers' images of and beliefs about teaching, which are formed over 12 years or more of observing their teachers' teaching and mostly doing chalk and talk teaching. And this may exert a powerful influence on the development of their professional identity and on beginner teacher practices. If these naive understandings of the teaching profession, based on the superficial observation of the school teachers, are not reflected on critically and deconstructed effectively, it might cast an unfavorable shadow over the training aimed at shaping the kind of teacher needed in the dynamic context of the 21st century. In this book, 3 chapters report on the research findings on how a work-integrated learning excursion can assist first-year BEd students in getting better understandings of their future career. The 3-day excursion exposes the first-year student teachers to aspects of teaching from practice that they were not aware of. We hope that it will contribute to their professional development as student teachers by having a better understanding of the profession. The activities, done in small cooperative learning groups of usually 5, are all based on a pedagogy of play, where student teachers engage as homo ludens, or we refer to it as the playing human. The activities were scaffolded using engaging pedagogies such as cooperative learning, problem-based learning, and case-based learning to optimize active learning and reflection by student teachers and to develop their self-directedness. The following chapters report on the excursion. Chapter 5 emphasizes the value of self-directedness in pre-service teacher education. The authors argue that self-directed learning is enhanced through excursions, bridging the eternal dilemma of the theory-practice divide. Chapter 7 discusses the different perspectives of will and the teaching practice divide, opting for case-based teaching by means of dramatization as a bridge to overcome the divide. The authentic cases written by seasoned teachers were given to student teachers, and in groups of 10, they had to write screenplays based on the provided cases, do the casting, and dramatize the cases. After each of the dramatized cases, a discussion and reflection took place for the students to understand the influencing factors that might not necessarily be visible during the dramatization. In the chapter, the authors reflect on such embodied cognition. The National Development Plan reports that alongside poverty and unemployment, a divided society is primarily concerned primarily concerned facing South Africa, is one of the most unequal countries in the world. Chapter 10 aims to create awareness among students of a diverse classroom environment they will possibly be facing when they go back to teach. The emphasis of this chapter is on diversity and equality through playing games. During the games, a strong argument for social justice is presented. A specific focus is on how the excursion ensures student teachers' awareness, exposes their cultural biases, and helps them to identify personal barriers to teaching for diversity. The activity is wrapped up with a reflection discussion. In all these activities, student teachers are challenged to identify their own developmental needs and to convert it into their own developmental goals in order to grow as student teachers. Thank you.
Thank you, Neal. Then there are still 8 more chapters in the book, and I will briefly discuss give an overview of the other chapters. Chapter 2 deals with research on sophisticated virtual simulation that supplement traditional teaching practice in schools. The chapter focuses on research where teacher educators created scenarios using a platform called Teach Live, allowing student teachers to practice certain target skills. Chapter 3 focuses on an important challenge related to pre-service teacher education and work-integrated learning, namely the open distance learning context. We know that a university like UNISA graduates many student teachers every year. And what are the challenges faced in pre-service teacher education at open distance learning institutions? Chapter 4 is a very exciting chapter, authored by colleagues at the University of Johannesburg, and it focuses on teaching schools. Now, based on best practices in Finland, I think the Finnish has the gold standard when it comes to pre-service teacher education. The UJ Faculty of Education established South Africa's first teaching school in 2010. It's called the Funda Ujabule School in Soweto. And in this chapter, the authors reflect on a decade of research in South Africa's first teaching school, and what are the experiences of teacher educators as well as student teachers, and also how do we approach appointing and training mentor teachers at such a teaching school. I know they also just touch upon legislation and what are the implications of such teaching schools in terms of the School Act. Chapter 6, written by Elsa Mens and myself, focuses on lessons that we could learn from Finland in terms of building pre-service teacher education on self-directed learning principles. And in the chapter, Elsa and I utilize third-generation cultural historical activity theory as a research lens in analyzing the data. Chapter 8 focuses on ways to address the so-called apprenticeship of observation that Neal spoke to, and the role of a potential orientation program for first-year BEd students. I'm not going to talk more about it. I think Neal has given a very good overview of Lorty's apprenticeship of observation and why it is so important in the context of pre-service teacher education. Chapter 9 focuses on the role of reflection as a vehicle for self-directed learning during the work-integrated learning of student teachers. In Chapter 11, Sarah Gravett and I focus on an innovative intervention in which student teachers were given the opportunity to teach life sciences to learners from a top-performing school that did not offer life sciences as a subject, and the student teachers actually became the teachers for an entire year. In this chapter, we highlight the affordances of a phenomenon called prolepsis and the Japanese lesson study approach, and what are the affordances of the Japanese lesson study in pre-service teacher education. The last chapter, chapter 12, focuses on some of the complexities in terms of teacher education in both pre-service and in-service contexts. Amongst others, the authors explore the role of induction programs and internships. From what has been said by the three of us, it should be clear that this book is devoted to the scholarship in the field of pre-service teacher education. The target audience of this book comprises scholars working in the field of pre-service teacher education. We hope that you will enjoy the book. Thank you very much.